Hello, everyone. We're going to talk about a nice general overview of the muscles and joints of the body that can be associated with the differing types of arthritis. Hello, everyone. This is Dr. Jason West with the West Clinic, coming at you with 102 years of healing and four generations of doctors. We see a lot of patients that don't fit the mold, where they are a round peg that we're trying to push into a square hole. We never see easy cases. And one of the video requests that I got was talking about regional arthritis. Now, what does regional arthritis mean? There's over 100 types of arthritis. There's osteoarthritis, there's rheumatoid arthritis, there's inflammatory arthritis, metabolic arthritis. I mean, it's a big, big mouthful to get all of the arthritides out there. And so I just thought I'd make a video about some regional considerations for arthritis, because arthritis basically means inflammation of the joint. It's really common. Sometimes it's not very well understood. So I just thought I'd go to the different areas of the body and start talking about what could be going wrong and the arthritides. I may miss some of them. And so in the comment section, if I miss something or if you want to see a specific video about arthritis, tell me and we'll make one. So let's just start with your hands and feet and work up to the head. So the first thing that we look about for hand arthritis is to see if we're developing something called Hebberdine's nose. So these are little osteoarthritic markers. You get little bumps on the fingers, and it basically, it's a sign that we're losing the joint space, the joints are coming closer together, you get a deformation of the joint, and things like glucosamine, chondroitin, acetylmaristoleate are really good. But something that my grandfather taught my dad and my dad taught me was that raw pecans really, really help with those swollen, irritated little knuckle joints, those Hebberdine nodes. And so a handful of raw pecans, it can't be in pecan pie, it can't be candied pecans or chocolate dip pecans, just raw pecans I've seen have really good clinical outcomes for Hebberdine's nodes. The other things that can affect those joints in the fingers are things like rheumatoid arthritis and gout. Now, rheumatoid arthritis has a tendency to be a little bit more bilateral or systemic. It kind of seems to happen in both hands at the same time. That's not always the case. But for gout, it really is unilateral. It likes to kind of go after one joint, likes to really go after the thumb. Same thing with the big toe in the foot. Now, going to the wrist and talking about wrist arthritis. This can come from trauma. A lot of times people will be either skiing or they'll trip and fall and they'll reach out and get their wrists into extension and crunch that area. And so it can be a traumatic or osteoarthritis, but also looking at systemic arthritis. And I think it's really important to upregulate the immune system, make the immune system healthier before going into a biomodular DMARDs or TNF inhibitor therapy. And so many times we get people coming into the office and they're requesting alternatives and considerations to the traditional approach, and that's one of the things that we offer. Now, moving up to the elbow, see a lot of tendonitis. Sometimes you can have ulnar nerve entrapment that's occurring in the elbow and some metabolic conditions there, but a lot of trauma associated with that. You can have golfer's elbow, which is medial epicondylitis, or you can have tennis elbow, which is lateral epicondylitis, and some regenerative injection therapy where you're taking little bits of vitamins and some type of mild irritant like dextrose 5%, oxidative medicine, neural prolotherapy to stimulate the body to go into healing mode are all really good considerations. Now, when your shoulder's not working, a couple things to happen. I always want to evaluate and see if there's some type of rotator cuff irritation. There's four muscles that basically hold the shoulder in place. And if you put someone through the paces as far as identifying those muscles, you can determine it's a rotator cuff. There's also a bursitis. There's also adhesive capsulitis. There's a lot of different arthritises that can affect the shoulder. And then moving into the spine. We talked earlier about a previous video about ankylosing spondylitis. You can have degenerative joint disease, which means the vertebrae are coming closer together. You can get a pinched nerve that's going down the arm. It can go down in between the shoulder blades. It can go just to the shoulder, to the elbow, to the wrist. And an orthopedic evaluation where you're doing a range of motion, you can do specific tests to stretch the ligaments, to entrap irritated nerve roots, to determine if there is a degenerative joint or intervertebral disc syndrome are all considerations. It's nice to have some plain films or x-rays, you know, looking at you from the front and the side, and then doing an oblique view where we can look down the intervertebral foramen and see if there's enough space there. It may require some advanced imaging like an MRI, and then going down through the back into the thoracic spine. The thoracic spine is relatively protected by the ribs, so it's not as common. Actually, it's fairly rare to get a disc herniation in the thoracic spine, but you can get some Schmorl's nodes. You can get a biomechanical deformation called a kyphosis, where you become hunched forward, or it's one of the easier places to see something called ankylosing spondylitis. Now, 80% of the population at some point will have some type of low back episode. And most of the time it's caused by improper biomechanics or some type of trauma, and you can get sciatic problems, and you can get sacroiliacitis. It's one of the places where ankylosing spondylitis likes to go, is that sacroiliac joint. But there are many metabolic conditions basically you can show in the lumbar spine. Now, when you go to the hips and you think about arthritis in the hips, it can be hip dysplasia. It can be, which means that you didn't have a properly formed hip joint. We can have osteoarthritis, which that ball and socket joint of the hip just kind of wears out. Instead of having a nice ice cream cone looking joint, it gets to be square. It's like we're having a rusty hinge, or we're pouring gravel into a ball bearing joint. It just doesn't function very well. Having people lay on their back and then you rotate the hip, internal, external rotation is one of the considerations to rule out osteoarthritis. Hip films or x-rays where you do an AP lateral and a frog leg so that you can show the different spaces when the joint is moving are considerations. And then the knee. Now there's a lot of different things that can happen in the knee. Osteoarthritis, you can have rheumatoid arthritis, you can have crystalline deposition disease, we can have gout, but usually you want to rule out, make sure there's no trauma, and then going up and down the stairs, if it's hurtful to go up and down the stairs, it's a classic sign of osteoarthritis. There's a million things that can cause knee arthritis, but the joint lubrication therapy through prolozone therapy or neural prolotherapy or prolotherapy are really good considerations. I'm not opposed to any type of medical intervention. Whatever helps the patient is effective, but whenever possible, if we can avoid a steroid, a cortisone injection, because there was a recent paper that I read that showed that people that had a steroid injection or people that had some type of physical therapy or regenerative injection therapy, they all seemed to have initially pretty similar results. We start doing rehab, we start doing regenerative injection therapy stimulation. What's interesting is about a year or two, 3 years later, the people that got steroid injections don't seem to hold their treatments. They have repeat fault problems at higher levels than people that are trying rehab. Now, I think it's really important whenever possible to not put any type of prescriptive medications in your body unless necessary. I don't like to put in healthy things in your system or unnatural things in your system unless it's absolutely warranted. And then the last thing to talk about for just a real generalized arthritic considerations in your feet, you can have plantar fasciitis, which is an irritation of the membrane along your feet, the spring ligament. It starts to pull away the bone on the bottom of the foot. You can have some Achilles tendonitis. You can have a lot of metabolic considerations. You can have inflammatory and infectious arthritis, and going to a holistic provider that's versed in nutritional considerations, biomechanic, orthopedic considerations, or to grow to an integrative medical facility like our clinic. There's other clinics like that across the United States to get a thorough workup, because once you know the cause, then we can talk about considerations of what's the best way to put you back together. I really like Humpty Dumpty medicine. Humpty Dumpty is the nursery rhyme where you fall off the wall and you're in pieces, and then someone starts to put you back together again. For me, in my office with our providers, it doesn't matter who gets the credit. As long as the patient gets better, I know there are other doctors out there, and that's just a systemic review of the different kinds of arthritis and different kinds of conditions for joint problems. There's tons of other conditions. And in the comment line, if you'll ask me about arthritis, or a specific condition We'll make a video of it. This is Dr. Jason West, and we'll see you on the next video.